Elder Tashriq Bey. Were the Umayyads, the Arab invaders, were they Moors?
Yes.
Guys, proud of you.
Three.
Shoot. Four guys proud of me. Be the man.
Be the man.
I dedicated this video to my brother Sabir Bey to help educate him from what I feel is a lot of misinformation he's been spewing and miseducating Black people. So I wanna correct that. Plus, I've challenged him to some mature discussions and he's refused over the last few years. So I said, you know what? I'm just gonna do my own little presentation and just kick the information. So, bam. This is a noble. She's an upper class. Her slaves are Black. She's a Tuareg. That's what they look like. They have an Arab-Berber look. Arab and Berber are different, but you have to understand when Arabs came and crossed the Sahara and began the Arab slave trade and eventually ended up Northwest Africa, North Africa. They mixed with the Berbers. They actually brought Islam to Berbers, who's been there for thousands of years. But they got along and blended and went about fighting the world with Islam together. So sometimes you have a lot of Arabs that married Berbers and they're all mixed up. You can't tell who's a Berber and who's an Arab, really. They're kind of synonymous. The Arabs and Berbers are the Moors. They're the real Moors. They're the white Moors. They are the people who conquered the Iberian Peninsula in Spain. Not no Black people. You were slaves of Berbers. You were slaves of Arabs. You were slaves of Tuaregs. You were slaves of all three of them people. And I'm not saying that as a slight, but I'm just trying to lay proper history so people can stop trying to lay claim to some people called the Moors. Because in reality, you know what you're doing? You're claiming to be a captured slave and servant of Berbers. When American Moors, these Black Moors out here, noble draw lead, bloodline, intellectual bloodline, mirrors, whatever you want to call yourself, you guys are claiming to be, because a lot of Moors, every time they want to try to show you some Moors or Black or Black Moors, they always, 100% of the time, will show you pictures of Tuaregs. But they're showing you pictures of Tuaregs that are assimilated Tuaregs, slaves and servants. So they're claiming to be a slave and a servant of Berbers, of Tuaregs, of Arabs. That's not no good, proud thing or some of the to be trying to dig up and all that. You're confused, American Moor. Sabir Bey, you're confused. And you teaching Black people this foolishness. This foolishness, tomfoolery. So, just so people can understand about this fez hat issue, as you see in all the videos, all the pictures of everything I showed, You didn't see any Arab Berber Moor Touareg with a red fez hat on. Not one time. What we seen were turbans. We seen turbans. Y'all didn't see no red cone hat. It's because Northwest African people in that area really don't wear fezes. Okay? You know who wear the fez? Which a lot of Afrocentrics confused, and I'm the one who first dropped this. Nobody had a clue. And I cleared all the, I'm the one who first started teaching people that the Moors were Arab and Berber. I got videos to prove it. So look, the Askari, those are the people who wear the fez. Let's read who, what an Askari is. An Askari means it's a soldier or in the military, was a local soldier serving in the armies of the European colonial powers in Africa, particularly in the African Great Lakes, Northeast Africa, and Central Africa. Now, the Askari has nothing to do with North Africa or Northwest Africa. They're in Central Africa, East Africa, Northeast Africa. They're nowhere near that. Okay? They were the fez. And the Askari are the police. The designation is still in occasional use today to informally describe police. That's what the Askari is, the police. They were Africans who helped European colonial powers in Central Africa. All them videos you see with Sabra Susan Shetty showing in Italy and Mussolini and all that, that's over in Ethiopia and Central Africa. They ain't got nowhere near Morocco. They wouldn't wear no red cone hats up there. They was wearing turbans like I showed you. So look. These are the Askari. Right here. Soldiers of the King's African Rifles, they also call. The Askari and King's African Rifles are the same people. This is in 1902. You see the fez with the tassel hanging? Out of House of Mir Bey and all these Moors got this confused is beyond me. But no, it's not beyond me. I know why. Because they were miseducated. They didn't know no better. They didn't even know their history. American Moors wearing a red fez hat is wearing a police uniform hat. That's the hat of the police. King's African Rifles. That's who wore the fez. These Negroes got it all twisted. You know what I'm saying? Wait. There they go. There they go. What did it say right there? Askari in training. Riflemen. These are policemen for European colonial forces with their little cone fez hat. That's what they did. Look. Eritrean Askari. You see the fez hat? What the hell is Samir Bey and them talking about? This is in Central Africa. This is right here is like East Africa. Eritrean Askari. Yeah? Mussolini's forces and shit. I mean, that's what they're doing. These American Moors are wearing this shit. Ain't got nothing to do with what they did in North Africa and turbans in Morocco. The Moroccan Touaregs and all them wore turbans. Wait, let me see some more pictures. There we go right there. Askari monument. The Askari is the police. Look at what his rifle. That's the police. Askari monument in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania. Where's Tanzania? That's Central Africa. Dedicated to Askari soldiers who fought in the East African campaign of World War I. That ain't got shit to do with Morocco. Wait, let me see if I get some more pictures. Shit. So, real quick, now that we know
what people do is they talk to the wrong people, and they talk to a lot of these weak behind Moors in these Moor science temples. Let me explain. I don't take sides, and I'm going to say this again. The weak behind Moor science temple Moors. If you are Moor that's in the temple, you got an issue that is not severe-based problem. I am not a Moor science temple Moor. But don't go to the Moor science temple thinking that they are the answers to everything that's going on. Period. Don't go to them. They don't even have no credibility. None. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. Listen to me. Listen, I want y'all to get what I'm saying to y'all. All of these boys doing these videos on YouTube and Facebook talking crazy. I will call you bluff. I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco.
That the L emerges from Syria.
What?
It's from Syria. From Syria. And it trickles down to their slaves, the Arabs. And it becomes part of Islam. And then it comes to you as slaves. Right? Wanting better treatment from the Arabs. Right? Being Malawis or commanders of their general. I mean, commanders of their army. Right? Things that happen to something like Al-Kahina's. The Arabs murdered Al-Kahina. That's why I was talking to Shaka on the couch. The Arabs murdered Al-Kahina. They murdered her. You know what her sons did? Her sons joined the Arab forces as commanders. They seek vengeance for their mother.
No tengo chavo.
No chavo.
Move and run! Move and run! Go!
What are you doing, huh?
Soar!
You ain't down with us no more. You ain't down. You ain't bad. You ain't bad.
You ain't bad. You ain't nothing. You ain't nothing.
Do you know if the Moors themselves actually called themselves Moors? You know, that's
debatable.
Really,
that's debatable. But I'll tell you, no. No. Our people didn't call themselves that. It was other people calling them Moors to identify their race and who they was. That's what that was. They Moors or something like that. But nah, man, we are African people. We are African, brother. Our ancestors called themselves Africans, and we could go back and Jabari could even show you the slides where they called themselves African. So no, they didn't call themselves Moors. In fact, when you look at the historical Moors, they wasn't talking about no laws. They were fighters. They were killers. They was going up against the army. They wasn't sitting back writing no damn laws talking about you got don't call yourself black and you can't go by this and we have our own national. They wasn't doing none of that. So no, brother, we was not calling ourselves that. We were African people, brother. And we are African people.
He likes to identify himself as a Moor. So I just, I asked him, I said, yo, can you show me in writing somewhere where these Moors actually called themselves, where they identified themselves as that? Not somebody from the outside who's writing about them calling them that. I want you to show me them identifying themselves as Moors. And I can't find it anywhere.
Well, you can find it this Saturday. I think I might put on a pair of my Moorish shoes. You know what I'm saying? I got some Moorish shoes. You'll find it there. I'll take it off and let you look in the inside. You'll probably see Maury.
Oh, you're terrible. All right. I just got one other question.
Go ahead, brother.
Just really quickly, in response to the question you just asked, let me say to you that the challenge with finding the way that Moors refer to themselves is partially because that's really loud. Is partially because when we refer to the Moors, we're talking about a group of people that actually were multinational. Exactly. Why this is kept, many of them were multiracial, and they existed over a very long period of time. So in some ways, what we're doing is we're collapsing a group of people under a term that they did not use themselves.
Right.
I really appreciate that some people are trying to go back to a time when people of African descent were a global people, were doing amazing things and teaching the large segments of the population of Earth. And I get why they're connected to the Moors. But I think that sometimes when we try to describe who those great people were, we get a little bit sloppy with our descriptions.
Definitely, because what I find in the reading is, you know, the Moors, oh, yeah, the great Moors who ran in Spain, yeah, they did this, they did that, they invented this, they did that. But when you look at the names that they're mentioning, they're Arabs. Yeah, these people don't want to say
there you
Arabs
go, brother.
More.
There you go.
So I'm like, what are you talking about? All the names, all the official names are Arabs. You know what I mean? Yeah. It doesn't make any sense.
They're multinational Islamic people for the most part, and also multiracial. Not every Moor was someone that looked like an African. And so I think that we need to acknowledge that while there were certainly Africans that were prominent during the period in those groups of people that we consider Moors, there certainly were. I'm not saying they weren't African. I'm saying they weren't all African.
Exactly.
We get really sloppy when we try to describe them. And I try not to beat up our brothers and sisters who are Moors unless they say something that I think really puts them out of the bounds, like we're not Africans, that kind of stuff I go after them on. But the reality is they're trying to put together our history, piece together a history that was kept from us as well. So it's difficult. It's not easy. I understand what they're trying to do, even though I think sometimes they need to be a bit more disciplined about the scholarship they're bringing to an understanding of history.
Yeah, because I feel like with their scholarship, what they're trying to do is the same thing that Europeans did, and they're trying to rewrite everything as black. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And it's not that quite simple, because when you start naming names, you're naming Arabs. Mm. So it just don't make any sense. But my second question is also concerning them. These Moors that were in Spain, do you know if they wore fezes?
They wore turbans. They wore turbans.
Yeah, turban ain't a fez, though. I want to know if they wore fezes.
Well, you can go back and you'll see some of them wearing them, the bucket hats or the fez, what they call it, the fez. Yeah, some of them had on fez, some of them had on the turbans. They was going back
in
and
Spain?
Forth. In Spain?
In Spain?
I don't know.
I think the turbans in Spain.
Yeah, all the images I see of Moors, and I haven't studied this exhaustively, I should say, this particular topic exhaustively. But I believe that most of those people we would consider Moors who are in Spain were often wearing turbans. The fez is a hat that comes from us from the area around Turkey. And it was conflated with ancient peoples, ancient Islamic peoples who existed in the area. And so there's some confusion around the fez as well. And I think that we need to be a bit more disciplined about how we describe those people that did amazing things that were also African. And that's a challenge.
All right. Okay, so thank you, brother. I appreciate it.
Questions to answer. Thanks
a
lot, man.
All right.
Thank you,
dear
brother.
Peace and black power, Jabari. Thank you for coming through, brother. I appreciate you.
Yep.
All right.
Yep.
Peace to you. Got any closing statements?
To the family. Yeah, it's always a pleasure to talk to the family. People I agree with and disagree with. The reality is that as a community, we have to have a higher dialogue, a better dialogue, so we can really understand what we have to do. There are people who just within the last 50 years lived in nations that were completely impoverished, and they have moved forward. It may take in great leaps. It is time for the African to take great leaps as a global people as well. So hopefully these dialogues will help us understand who we are so we understand what we have to do. So Sonetta, my dear brother, it's always good to spend some time with you. You know, that's my brother, Sonetta. So let's get it in and keep up the work, family.
All right. Peace, Brother Jabari.
Now, on the slavery tip, let me just go on and put the smash down on that bullshit. Because the fact is this, that it's not something that you can just sweep under the rug. It was the global fucking economy. And the fact that you're still on the fence lets me know that I can't trust you. You're still riding it. You can't sweep something massive as the global fucking economy, meaning that North America, South America, Africa, Europe, and Asia was involved. It is no way in fucking hell that you can sweep the global fucking economy under the rug that went on for over 400 years. You understand what I'm saying? You have Africans who have oral traditions that have never taken one paragraph from a cracker's book. How do you justify saying where the cracker, the slave trade is a story invented by the cracker? When you go down there to Brazil, they're not reading out of no fucking cracker's books. When you go to fucking Cuba and they speak about the slave trade, because in Havana was one of the largest slave ports in the world, they're not reading from no crackers' books. These are oral traditions that are handed down from parent to child, from grandparent to grandchild. You understand what I'm saying? With no cracker nowhere in the process. So you bullshitting, man. You straight up fucking bullshitting. Where's the logs? Where's the fucking ships? How many motherfuckers get murked out here and niggas throwing away the fucking gun? What you think motherfucker gonna say, here it is? I did it? You understand what I'm saying? Come on, man, let's be fucking real, man. Real motherfuckers do real fucking things, man. And you motherfuckers still out there riding the motherfucking fence on our slave trade. I can't let it slide. Because if I don't show my people how the fuck they got in this shit, they ain't gonna never have the fucking initiative to get up out of it. Because they won't know how. How the fuck is they gonna know how to get up out of something? And they don't even, these motherfuckers out here don't even, they feel like they deserve to be in this fucking position. When you, all you teach a motherfucker is that he's a motherfucking cannibal savage. Never had no motherfucking history. And then you teach a motherfucker about America is his homeland, while the fucking Christian, the Jew, and the fucking Arab is fleecing Africa for the fucking mineral wealth. I ask myself, I say, damn, what would make these motherfuckers come out and say it wasn't no slave trade? And then I had to think, who would most profit from a falsehood like that? Who would most profit? The cracker? The Jew? And that low-lifed Arab? And an old Uncle Tom bitch-made-ass nigga getting the fucking crumbs that the slave master giving? You understand what I'm saying? This is a fucking shame that y'all riding the fucking fence on an issue that was as massive as five fucking continents. It is no way one man can dictate that information, and it's a global economy. You have documents, you have recollection, because our peoples are storytellers. They passed them tradition down for 100, if not thousands of years. If you go into fucking West Africa, those traditions are handed down orally. A griot is to memorize the history of his people orally. And a lot of those oral traditions have never been tampered with. They know exactly what happened. Quit acting as if the cracker got all the information about slavery. Nigga, quit riding the fence. Cause I see you. I see you. I cannot let you, you understand what I'm saying? Take my ancestors' memories and just juggle with them when I get a little information and dog. You got to be strong, man. You got to fucking boss up with this shit, man. Just like I looked on the motherfucking videos and I seen the motherfucking the Moors or whatever the fuck you wanna call them. Moriscos. All I know is I identify the motherfucker with the hat. You understand what I'm saying? That's just like when niggas bang today. If a motherfucker, if he red, he red. If he blue, he blue. So when I see that motherfucking fez on that motherfucker head, I automatically identify him with a certain philosophy, a certain culture, a certain political view. You understand what I'm saying? And as I show you, them same brothers with them fezzes on that's attacking our goddamn people in Africa, you show me the brothers with the fezzes on that's trying to repulse them motherfuckers. You can't show me that. You understand what I'm saying? You cannot show me that because it's deeper than that. Those motherfuckers are Islamized blacks. And a motherfucking Muslim Islamized black, they only respect Islam. They only respect Islam. They look down on every other religion, every other culture as heathen, as idolatrous, and they attack it. The fucking Moors came down and sacked the University of Jenin, which was 500 years old at that time. That's like when the fucking Greeks burned down the fucking Library of Alexandria, man. What the fuck history we lost? That shows you that they were so Arabized that the same university that taught them motherfuckers, because it didn't just go from Egypt across North Africa up into Spain. That motherfucking knowledge went from Egypt into West Africa long before it went up into Spain. Ghana, Mali, Songhe, you even see the Dogon, which teach that their knowledge came up out of the Nile. So that knowledge went from the Nile and it moved into West Africa. And then from West Africa, that's where the knowledge came from that went up into Spain. And these motherfuckers come back down in Africa and destroy the same motherfucking university that taught they ass. That's a Arabized, Islamized, no having knowledge of self, more black ass nigga. That's what it is. They no different than Darfur. And I say, damn, let me go do some research on this J.A. Rock. Where my fucking book at? I ain't gonna give y'all motherfuckers too much or how I'ma bust y'all ass. Cause if you come out in any type of motherfucker debate on me, believe me, I'm not playing no games. I'm a motherfucking mercenary when it come to this motherfucking history. I'm coming to do damage, goddammit. And I'm gonna have it laid out. So if you ain't thorough about this motherfucking research, don't show up. Cause I'm coming with my people on my back. And I'm not gonna lose. Ain't no motherfucking losing. I'm coming to drop the goddamn facts. You understand what I'm saying? I'm doing J.A. Rogers and World's Great Men of Color. Because I was looking at Renoco's video on the Moors. And he was saying that the Moors fought side by side with Hannibal. But for some reason, they broke the allegiance. And I say, damn, let me go do the research on it. So I look Massinacius in World's Great Men of Color by J.A. Rogers, and he drops the knowledge on the Moor, whom they call, at that time, equivalent Numidia. from which Massinissus was the goddamn ruler. And he was in love with Hannibal's niece. But they gave that woman up in marriage to another man, and Massinissus felt betrayed, and he sided with Rome and Scipio Africanus against Hannibal. God damn, man, y'all motherfucker got a long resume of being a traitor. How the fuck is you gonna fight against Hannibal, your brother, your African brother, Moor brother, whatever you want to call it, for the low-life, the imperialistic Rome? Read up, motherfucker. Read up on Massinissus. Another traitor. You understand what I'm saying? Got a long motherfucking resume. Now, I dare you to show me what Moors stood up in our defense when we needed them. Show me. Show me those Moors. I'm looking for them. Now, I respect the historical Moor. I revere that history when they went into Spain and all the sciences that they brought up out of Timbuktu, the University of Jenin. But damn, when they came back, they had lost it. They had lost it. So the only greatness about the Moors that we can even speak about was that highlight in Spain. After that, there is no more that you can speak of in any great conversation that the Moors was something that we should revere. God damn, y'all destroyed Ghana and Songhe. Up under Massinissus, you traded on Hannibal. And then I asked myself, damn, the historical Moor was an Orthodox Muslim. He didn't read out of no Circle 7 Quran. He didn't follow no Noble Drew Ali. They didn't recognize Confucius and Buddha as no fucking prophets. So I asked myself, damn, based on the historical Moor and what they believe, they went to Mecca. They didn't come to no fucking Morocco, even though that was their area in which they inhabited. They all went to Mecca. They took their pilgrimages to Mecca. You ain't hear no motherfucker over here talking about no land over here was their original homeland. Them people knew where the hell they came from, even though they was fucked up in the head talking about they was related to Muhammad rather than call themselves an African. So I asked myself, damn, man, besides saying that y'all the Moor Science Temple, what the fuck truly historical about you is really Moorish? If we are to identify, even if we deal with Massinissus in Numidia, they wasn't reading out of no Circle 7 Quran. They didn't follow no Noble Drew Ali. They didn't revere no damn Buddha or no damn Confucius as no damn prophet. So what about y'all is original from these original Moors? And if you're going to accept Egypt as being a part of the Moorish Empire, if you're going to do that, Amun-Ra is older than Allah. Ptah is older than Allah. Asa is older than Allah. Aset is older than Allah. Heru is older than Allah. Why y'all don't call on the oldest name of the deities? Why you still going to 101s and they talking about Mecca is the original Garden of Eden? And you know damn well in Egyptian texts, they don't speak of no goddamn Mecca or no damn Canaan being no Garden of Eden. We came from the beginning of the Nile, where God happy dwells at the foothills of the mountains of the moon. In Central East Africa, that's from the papyrus of Hunepa. They know better than anybody. Read the Egyptian text. That's why I ask, I say, damn, Noble Drew Ali says he's an Egyptian adept. But damn, I ask myself, damn, what was truly about him that was Egyptian? When you deal with the culture, he didn't teach you about the 42 negative confessions of Maat. He didn't teach you about Abydos and Aswan Philae. Waset, the Grand Lodge of Waset, the Grand Temple of Luxor, the Valley of the Kings. He didn't teach you about the dynastic, the kings of the dynastic periods. He didn't. What is Egyptian about it? There's nothing. How in the hell you gonna be Egyptian and you talking about Jesus? Ain't no damn Jesus in ancient Egypt. He didn't even exist. And so what the hell is we talking about? Jesus in the times of ancient Egypt, Mecca didn't exist. So why is we talking about Mecca? And then he's an Egyptian adept. I have a right to ask that question. You understand what I'm saying? And if we're going to say, well, the man literature may be outdated. You knew it was outdated, but you rolled with it until I came out on that shit. You understand what I'm saying? When I showed the video that there were Moors in Africa with the fez on, fighting with the peckerwood against our people, you didn't come out and say, well, those were Moriscos until I came out on it. Why didn't you bring this goddamn knowledge and say, well, hey, these are bad Moors, we're good Moors. You understand? This is how you recognize them. You didn't do that. You didn't do that. So don't come out now and try to ride the fucking fence.
Now I'ma pass the mic to my lovely wife. She's a fly MC and the light of my life. So to bust a rhyme without further ado, take it away, Mary Sue.
Jesus Christ is my nigga. He's the son of the original G. And he was sent to Earth to elucidate the way that we should be.
What?
Like if another MC says, you're a freak, you're a lame butt rapper and your rhymes are weak. I don't get mad and I don't critique, I forgive him and turn the other cheek. I don't blaspheme and I don't brag, I don't cuss, and my pants don't sag. I do exude a little Christian swag and I'm proud to be an American.
Jesus Christ is a nigga. Let his light shine through ya. Let his love pop a cap in your butt and say hallelujah. Jesus Christ is a nigga. He's a homie MCJC, you see. He's an honest, caring.
So I want to deal with what makes the prophet Noble Drew Ali an expert on science. In 1913, when we have Dr. Martin Delaney, who was a medical scientist, a physician, a historian, a fighter in the Civil War, someone who dreamed of one of our first Pan-Africanists, Dr. Martin Delaney. What makes the Prophet Noble Drew Ali a scientist when he doesn't know anything about science? He was not trained in science. So if you're not trained in science, how can you speak about science? More so, in the 1913, science was developing methodology in 1913. White folks were still dealing with religion and even couldn't separate concepts of evolution with their religious concepts of the creation of the world. So in the 1913, science and religion was having a conflict. What would make the Prophet Noble Drew Ali an expert on science in the 1913? Now, if he was prophesizing black in science means death, he didn't qualify what he meant. Did he talk about black the color? Black the people, black as an organism, black as a frequency. What was he talking about? See, in science now, you just can't make a statement like that and say, well, black in science means death. You have to specifically talk about the characteristics of what you are trying to analyze and use the methodology in that formula to actually solve the problem, right? So in 1913, science was a developing, it was more so an art in 1913. It was developing. So he has no credentials to say or to speak. And that's one of the things that we call a fallacy of authority. Fallacy of authority is when you say
I'm going to talk about science and make science the authority. So once I say science, then I can say black means death because science said it. So that's a fallacy of authority. But the problem is that the Prophet Noble Drew Ali had the authority to talk about religion, but he did not have the authority to talk about science. All of these Africans that went up into Western Asia and they were castrated, they left no seed. They left no seed. They left no children. And so that is the reason why you can explain why there is not a large population of Africans in now Iran and in Syria, right? And in Western Europe, right? Or in the Turkish Empire, is because when those eunuchs died, they had no seeds, they had no wives, they had no children, they had no population. So it was population control. Now, what I just said is that when you create a eunuch culture, the eunuchs don't give children, so there are no descendancies. So when you want to come up to me and say, Brother Reggie, and start talking about descendancy, right? And that's not descendable. You're not dealing with the Iranians and the Turks and the rest of the Arabs did to Africans. They made us non-descendable. But then you want to use these code words and act like we don't know what makes a person descendable or not. When you're a eunuch, you're not gonna be descendable. When you're a eunuch, you don't have any nationality. Your balls has got cut off. And you want to come to us in this period of time and start talking about we ain't got no nationality. See, the nature of the African, there were many nations in Northern Africa, North Africa, Central Africa, Southern Africa, right? So because there's so many of the nations, you know what we just call them? We call them black, right? Now, you have simplified it to be a Moorish nation, right? So that's like, you know, common denominator, right? Right? So in order to cover up all of these black African nationalities that you destroyed, you destroyed their nationality. Because they had nationalities before you came. Before the Umayyad came. Before the Abbasid came. Before all of those little tribal white dynasties came, Africans had nationality. Ghana, ancient Ghana, had a nationality. You took their nationality. Now you want to call them Moors, right? So, we ain't going to apologize for this. That's why we stand for blackness, right? Because we are not going to be aligned with something that we know destroyed our people. And we're not going to cover it up. So when I see these pictures of these eunuchs, right, it makes me cry. What does it do to you? It makes you turn the page, right? Because you're going to apologize for it. You're going to be like one of those Moors who, when you look at the picture side now, and you saw it in your own eyes, oh, he wasn't a Moor. But I'm going to show you during the debate who is a Moor and who's not a Moor, right? Because we have people like Al-Mansur. Al-Mansur went down and destroyed Timbuktu. He made them slaves. That's history. And he used black folks to do it. And he made them eunuchs and concubines too. And you're going to tell me that the people that was working, that were subjects of Al-Mansur, they were subjects. They had no nationality. So y'all want to play these little word games.
Hunts up. Yo, hunts up, homeboy. I mean, we got victims out there waiting for us.
What?
Homeboy ain't home. Nah, see, he up at Doomsbury playing tennis with his turtle shells. Yeah.
Back off me, man.
Man, foot's still down. You smell the Vic Rankford?
Get off of me, man. Stop it.
Are you back? Or is that what they teach you up at that little sissy school of yours? How to forget who your friends are? Well, let me tell you something. I don't care what they teach you up there. You either down or you ain't down. So the question is, are you bad or what?
Leave me alone.
I said,
leave me alone. I'm tired of you messing with me. Stop it.
Are you bad?
Stop it. Huh? Leave me alone. Stop. Get out of my way. Move. You want to see who's bad? You want to see who's bad? Come on. Come on, let's do it. Let's see who's bad, man. Come on. Come on. Let's go.
Let's do it.
Sabir Bey out here making videos about me now, lying. Sabir Bey is scared to have a discussion with any other man if it's not on his platform. I've offered him $300 and showed him everybody knows I offer Sabir Bey $300 to have a one-hour discussion, and he's shaking in his boots.
Bluff, yes, I am sitting in Spain. I just had to turn around and walk in a little alley to do this video because what you call cut me off. YouTube cut me off when I put Minister Farrakhan's name in it. So I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. Listen to me. Listen, I want y'all to get what I'm saying to y'all. All of these Moors doing these videos on YouTube and Facebook talking crazy. I will call you bluff. I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. Listen to me. Listen, I want y'all to get what I'm saying to y'all. All of these Moors doing these videos on YouTube and Facebook talking crazy. I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. I will call you bluff.
What up, fam? This is Chief X, the God Best Reincarnated, with some more common sense, science, reality, and truth. You see the name above, Sabir Bey, on here, lying to people again, miseducating the public on purpose, not an accident. This is on purpose. He's been doing this forever. I've called him on it. I've asked him and even wanted to pay him to come on his live stream, but he won't allow it because he don't want to be proved wrong in front of his followers. I just want you to see how Sabir Bey lies intentionally to people in America and in Spain. He's over here on a little vacation or whatever he's doing in Spain, and I want to show you a video clip of how he just blatantly lies to this French African brother while he's in Spain and tries to tell him that this guy was a Moor in Spain in the years of 700 to 1400. Remember, I said 700 to 1400.
You see what I'm saying? So once they got in by infiltration,
yes,
then that was the weakest.
Yes,
that was the weakest of their
hunger.
Yes, a lot of people don't know that. But you ever seen the Moorish chief? You got your phone?
Yes.
Look it up. I'm gonna show you the Moorish chief.
Yes.
It was inside the Alhambra. Just go Google the Moorish chief.
He's asking, has he seen the Moorish chief? Which is a picture, or a painting, excuse me, a famous painting that's in the Philadelphia Museum. But Sabir Bey and all the Moors always lie and act like it's a Moor at that time. There's even books written by some wrong scholars with this picture on the book cover, just misleading people.
What's his name? Just punch in Moore's chief.
The guy asked him what's his name. He said, oh, he just said, just punch in Moore's chief. He can't tell him his name.
Moorish chief, M-O-O-R. Chief, like separated chief. There you go, right there. Now click that. I want you to see the photo. Now click, go to the photos. You see that?
Don't go to the scholarship. Go to the picture, because you know niggas is picture prone. They see a picture, and I get all throwed off, but they never give you the art history of a picture. If someone is showing you a picture or a meme, ask them where is the source. Where is the art history of it? All most pictures have an explanation of what they are.
It looks like you. That was done in the Alhambra back then.
He just said that was done in the Alhambra back then. He's referring to between the times the Moors, which were Arab and Berbers, not West Africans, not Sub-Saharan Africans. They were Arabs and Berbers. So he said this is him in the Alhambra back then. Neither one of those two statements are true.
Oh, shit. Yeah. Eduardo Charlemagne. Yeah. Eduardo Charlemagne. Yeah. Inside that mosque. Inside the Alhambra. Mm-hmm. Oh. Right in there.
You heard him. Inside the Alhambra.
Most people don't even know about that. And he has a actually a fez on his head.
And told the man he got a fez on his head, which he doesn't. It's a turban. Sevier Bey is so disingenuous and fraudulent.
Oh, it's a famous painting in Philadelphia in the Art Museum.
Oh,
one of the famous, one of the most famous paintings in Philadelphia Art Museum.
Now, he knows it's in the Philadelphia Art Museum, but he won't give him the real story. He wants this man to walk away thinking that's how the Moors looked between 700 and 1400. Those are the people who conquered Spain. That's what he wants this man to believe. That's wicked behavior.
I would keep that.
Yeah, look it up.
Yeah,
I'm saying, look it up, brother. What's your name again?
Basi.
Yeah, Sabir. Sabir Ben. Yes, sir. No doubt. That's what you do. You teach and you build. You teach and you build. You see how that works? He's from France.
He said, you teach and you build. Yeah, he's trying to miseducate on purpose, like he always does. So let's go over here and see the real history of this picture. This picture today is titled The Moorish Chief. It wasn't when it was painted. Guess when it was painted? Guess when it was? 1878. They call it The Moorish Chief now in the Philadelphia Museum. 1878, that's damn near 1900. That is 400 whole years later from the Arabs and Berbers conquering Spain. 400 years later. Meaning, it's not in the Alhambra. And it wasn't a Moorish chief. The artist is Edward Clermont from Austria. He's an Austrian. It's an oil painting. The Moorish Chief. This is the art history of it. Source. Looking down at it, a tall man in a white robe standing in the doorway of an impressive palace. People have marveled at this painting's detailed and speculated about its subject for over 100 years, but no one knows for sure who the man is because this is not a portrait. The artist used a costumed model. It's a model. A model in costume standing in a Moorish palace. It's not the Alhambra. The painting is filled with many realistic details. Look at the man's clothing. He is dressed in the kind of hooded cloak, sometimes called a burnous,
and typically worn by Arabs and Moors. Arabs and Moors, it says. A Moor is any Muslim in Northwest Africa between that time period. Mainly Berbers and Arabs. On his head, a headdress, they call it a kafiyeh. It's not a fez like Sabir lied to him about. Sabir knows that's not a fez. It's a headdress that almost completely covers a crimson cap underneath. Okay, he's just talking about the history, but let's go down and see what it talks about. The background of this painting is based. Can y'all see that? The background of this painting is based on the Alhambra, a famous fortress overlooking the city Granada, Spain. The Alhambra was built during the 13th and 14th centuries by Moors, Arabs and Berbers. Now, Arabs did have African slaves. Or Sub-Saharan African and West African slaves. Okay? They weren't the chief of anything. They were the servant. By Moors. Muslims. Okay, look. It just corroborates what I said, actually. The Alhambra was built during the 13th and 14th century by Moors. Muslims from Northwestern Africa. Who ruled large portions of Spain from 700 to 1400. Okay, just like I said, West African, Sub-Saharan Africans never ruled or conquered Spain. That was what the Arabs did. That's Arab history, Arab and Berber history. Although Spain is part of the European continent, it is located just across the Straits of Gibraltar from North Africa. I always tell people you can swim from Morocco to Spain. The painting probably gets its current title, The Moorish Chief, from the Moorish architecture in the background. But when it was first exhibited in 1878, it was called the Guardian of Seraglio. Seraglio. Pronounce it Seraglio. I gotta roll the tongue, excuse me. Seraglio. That's the original name of the painting. The Guarding of Seraglio is the name for the special quarters. That's what the original name was. The Guarding of Seraglio. It is a name for the special quarters in a Muslim residence where the women of the household were sheltered from strangers, being protected by strangers. So the title identified the man as a guard of the women in the palace. A servant. A guard. He's not a chief. He's not running nothing. He's a servant. Arabs and Berbers enslaved West Africans and Sub-Saharan Africans, and they were servants, and they were Islamized. They weren't anybody special. So the title identified the man as a guard of the woman in the palace. He's working. But it's a painting, and just his imagination, though. But this is what's his imagination. He painted a black man guarding women, doing his job as a servant. However, after being purchased by Philadelphia collector John G. Johnson in 1892, the painting listed as the Alhambra Guard was another name when he bought it. The painting was listed as the Alhambra Guard. He's a servant. This title makes sense since the palace in the background resembles the Alhambra. It's not the Alhambra. He just painted what looked like the Alhambra with Moorish artwork. Finally, the painting came to Philadelphia Museum of Art. People began calling it Moorish Chief. People later just called it the Moorish Chief. So as you find that these different styles, so they called it the Moorish Chief because it had Moorish artwork in the background. Not because of any kind of
ethnicity reasons. It was just an imagine. That's what he used in his imagination, this painting. Okay? The artist, Edward Charlemont, made the figure, and the setting looks so true to life. Yeah. So that was it. And they, in the video, he also calls the Moorish chief Charlemont. But that's the name of Edward Clermont. Charlemont was born in 1848 in Vienna, the capital of Austria. His father was a professional artist who painted miniature portraits. He just goes on to tell you how he uses imagination from different books he read and things he's seen. And at that time, he was sure, because it's the fact, that any black in Spain more than likely was a servant or slave to the real Moors, who were Arabs and Berbers. Chief X, I'm out. Stop lying to people, Sabir Bey.
I will call you bluff.
Sabir Bey out here making videos about me now, lying. Sabir Bey is scared to have a discussion with any other man if it's not on his platform. I've offered him $300 and showed him, everybody knows I offer Sabir Bey $300 to have a 1 hour discussion, and he's shaking in his boots. So what he does is to avoid this discussion and to run from this discussion, he will say, okay, $300 is not enough to talk to me for an hour. Give me $1,000 and we can have a debate. This nigga wants somebody to pay him $1,000 to have a discussion. So those are just tactics that people do to kill the case, to make sure that they don't debate. Only thing I'm asking, say yes, Sabir Bey. I want to have a discussion. If you do, and your information you teaching is correct and right, you should be confident. You shouldn't be running around here scared for the last 2 years to talk. Now, I'm not offering no money no more. That was last year, and you've been running for a year. That thing is over. I'm just asking for a discussion for 1 hour. If you're right, what are you scared about? So, I'll give Xavier 10 minutes on my platform. Why your platform? Check this out. This is how fair and real I am. Fuck Chief X's platform. Fuck the Bears platform. Let's go to a neutral platform. I'm ready. Just say yes, Sabir Bey. You made two videos spitting fire on me today and lying to your people. But your people need to know you throwing up these taxes because you're scared to have a conversation with any other grown man outside of your platform for fear of exposure, for fear that it will be revealed that Sabir Bey has been lying to the people for a fucking decade straight. For a decade straight, Sabir Bey's intentions is to miseducate black people and confuse black people because he's been corrected and shown the truth 100 times over. So this is why he refuses to have a discussion. So it's out there, Sabir Bey. Just say yes. My answer is yes. We're yet to hear yes from you. I don't want to hear nothing else. Don't nobody inbox me. Don't post nothing on my comment thread. All I want to hear is Sabay Beer saying, yes, let's get it and have a discussion on someone else's neutral platform. Period. If he's not saying that, he's shaking in his boots. Don't believe any other excuse. Damn, I get it. Who got some questions? It's just Friday during the day. I'm kind of free. I took care of all my business.
No, Jerry Machiavelli, let me explain. I'm glad you came here. You say go on his line. We did that, Jerry. I went on his live almost a year ago. He tried to control the narrative and play mind games, and he didn't want to commit to a discussion. He didn't. Jerry, stop believing. This is Chief X right here. I'm not going to jive you. A topic of his choice. At the time, a year ago, we had a topic. I told him he can choose the topic to make him feel better. Because topic is always key. He didn't want to come up with a topic. He didn't want to schedule nothing. He just wanted you to come on the live at the drop of a dime and have a few words and bounce so he can seem like he'd said something and play a mind game with his people. No, nigga, let's go on a neutral site. You over here, I'm over here, and we're going to have a man-to-man fucking discussion. Get some fucking balls and let's have a discussion. What are you scared of if your info is right? Jerry Machiavelli, if a man's info is right, he is not scared to be challenged by no other man. If his info is sketchy and faulty and he's been lying for a decade, of course he's going to be scared to go on a neutral platform and discuss that shit. This is fucking common sense and logic. How are you confused, my brother? How is you confused? I listened to one of his streams just a minute ago. That's why let me make a live right now. I listened to it. He said out of his mouth. See, I don't have to lie on him. I can straight from his mouth. He said, Chief X can pay me $300 to come on my live stream for 10 minutes. What kind of pussy ass shit is that? And then you got his fanboys and groupies and this bitch all up in my inbox. I said, bitch, get the fuck up out my inbox with that bullshit. Talking about, come on, it's live. Come on, for 10 minutes. Why would I waste my time when I want to have a grown man discussion? He wants to have a kiddie discussion and talk over me for a few minutes and get me off his stream as if his broke ass is worth more than $300. You see where he streams at? Have you ever seen him streaming inside of his own motherfucking place? All he do is take money from you niggas, and he got a cash app and ask for donations. I've never in my life asked for a donation on any live stream I was on. And if you can find me doing that, I'll give you $100. I've never. Every single live stream Sabir Bay do, he's asking for cash donations. Why? He takes that money and goes on a little tour, bullshit y'all, and come back and be broke again in front. You can tell these niggas live with somebody, their mama, a guardian, or whatever. You can tell they do by where they film and record at. You see me filming and recording in the comfortability of my own fucking apartment. You see it? I live alone and pay my own bills. I'm not in my motherfucking car every fucking live stream running off with a mouth because I'm scared somebody in the house may hear me. These is mind games y'all fall for. Grown ass men got a place where they live and stay and shoot a video. They not always outside in the motherfucking car at the local Starbucks. Who with internet service hangs at Starbucks every day if they got a home of themselves for themselves? People who go to Starbucks is because they broke. They may not have internet service at home. They may not have comfortable living where they can shoot the shit like I'm doing right now. Y'all don't know that? All these fake niggas all on YouTube doing streams in their car and shit, all in the backyard and shit, in a motherfucking, you know, all this old dumb shit. That means a nigga's broke. And fronting for you. Tell Sabir Bay to do a live stream in his home. If he got a place to live, if he lives alone. Talking about $300 ain't enough.
Talking about $300 is not enough to talk to me for an hour. Get the fuck out of here, nigga. You sitting here doing live stream taking cash checks. Niggas giving you $5, $1, $10, $20. Nigga, I was talking about giving you $300 for an hour. And you want to act all high and mighty and civility like that? Like $300 is just pales? Like you can't even pay, you know, what the fuck is wrong with you, nigga? That's that bullshit. I'm trying to tell you, that's that bullshit. You see, you do live streams for the specific point every single fucking day. Go to this page and see. You do live streams every day because that's how you pay your bills and make it in life. You niggas ain't got no motherfucking job. You ain't got no motherfucking business. What's your business? Where do you work at? Live streams is your job. So guess what? If Chief X spanked your ass and proved that bullshit you're teaching is false, then guess what? Siberia's Bay people look at him sideways. Then he can't pay his motherfucking rent because his followers are left. And seeing he been jiving them for fucking 10 years. Oh, Sabir Bay got his ass spanked. Chief X intellectually abused his ass, so his money leaves. He won't dare chance that fucking with me.
I will call you bluff. I will call you bluff. Bluff. Yes, I am sitting in Spain. I just had to turn around and walk in a little alley to do this video because what you call cut me off. YouTube cut me off when I put Minister Farrakhan's name in it. So, I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. Listen to me. Listen, I want y'all to get what I'm saying to y'all. All of these boys doing these videos on YouTube and Facebook talking crazy. I will call you bluff. I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. Listen to me. Listen, I want y'all to get what I'm saying to y'all. All of these boys doing these videos on YouTube and Facebook talking crazy. I will call you bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this.
Rashid, peace. How's the consciousness? What's good, brother?
What's up?
Ain't nothing.
We ain't Africans. We ain't coming on no slave ship.
Yes.
And the slave story is grossly misunderstood.
Okay, so
and our
true,
people suffer from a lack of knowledge.
So if
and anytime the white man is going out of his way, it's Moorish Latin I'm speaking. And anyway, anything that the white boy gets behind and tells you to venerate, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm the European, right? When he tells you that, I'm the, you put it in snippets, put it on the screen. Put it, so David Mac Ritchie, so ancient
black.
And modern Britain.
I mean,
I'm the original European. And white is a color. And I'm not, I'm not a color. I'm not a, brother, I don't argue my science.
We're not arguing, brother. I'm just saying, you are European, you're saying.
And it's called oversimplification.
Mm-hmm.
Oversimplification is when people take what's called philosophically microhistory, they take bits and pieces of the story, and then they begin to weave it. And this is what we're victims of. We're victims of one story. We're victims of one story where some Africans got escorted to a ship and brought over here, and now we don't have no ship records. They got records for everything. They even got the Santa Maria, the Pina, all that sucker shit, Columbus was supposed to get on. They got all of them intact. They don't got no slave ships.
The log records.
They don't got no logs or none of that. It's a farce.
Slave ships, like, wow. Let's talk about this subject and really get into it.
Okay.
You know, so let's talk about slave ships. And what's the first thing that you can tell me when you think of the subject of slave ships?
Well, the first thing that I think about is that they were really just ships, not specifically slave ships, because what they were was cargo ships that got converted into slave ships.
What can you tell me about these cargo ships? You know, let's, you know, just start off with the basics. You know, ships existed. We have records of them everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
You know, slave ships weren't necessary. Ships weren't built to carry slaves. So for the most part, they were converted to carry slaves.
Yes. Okay. And now there were over 100 different kinds of ships, or you know, sailing vessels, the things that you travel on the water with. There was over 100 of them. Yes,
during colonial times.
And yes, and what I found out is, because I wanted to find out what kinds of ships were being used to transport the slaves.
Okay.
You know, so I did go to slavevoyages.org, which is a website that is dedicated to the transatlantic slave trade. What they have is they have about what they say is about 3/4 of the ships that docked in the Americas. They have about 3/4 of them documented. And so if you go there, you can find out where they documented their information from, which is from several sources. And so I use it as a trustworthy website to go to.
Okay.
So when I went there, and as I was researching these ships, I found out that there were really 5 particular kinds of ships that I kept running into over and over and over and over again.
Okay. And so, yeah, so just what kind of ships were there? What are their names?
Sloops, schooners, brigs or brigadiers, snows, and ships of the line, or what they just called them, just ships.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so these ships here, and not just these ships, but other ships. You know, the question is, okay, well, where were these ships being built? You know, it's a valuable question, because, you know, we talk about land, we're talking about resources as far as the timber is concerned, and a lot of other things that you need in order to build hundreds and thousands of ships, you know. So where were these ships being built during colonial times?
Okay, well, we know that ships were being built worldwide.
Right, know that the Chinese were building ships way before anything else, along with a whole bunch of other people, but we're talking about colonial times.
Okay, well, during that time, what is interesting is that I found out that while ships were being built worldwide, that the ships that the United States started building really turned out to be, and then the United States ships turned out to be the ship building ships that everyone wanted to use. And so the United States then became like the ship building capital
of the world.
Yes.
So
during the 1700s.
During the 1700s, through, as we asked ourselves the question, a valuable question, and we explore that, the facts have come out that, you know, America actually was the capital of the shipbuilding industry during the 1700s.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's very interesting, because, you know, that's not a part of American history that's really discussed. I actually don't remember that as a part of my public education.
Well, and they don't really tell these things. What was going on is that as these cities, or really as people were moving into the colonies, mm-hmm. you have to clear the domain. You have to clear it. So they had to clear cut trees so that you can make way for housing, schools, businesses. And so as these cities started getting bigger and bigger, they were tearing down the trees, and then they were using the lumber. Of course, the lumber was being used for all sorts of things, but the ships was one of the big things, because this is what was making money for the United States.
Right, as we said, you know, it became the capital of the shipbuilding industry. And so just think about the economic empowerment that it gave the United States, or at least the colonial United States, as it was developing. It was definitely a major part of the economic development, along with, of course, the slaves that were being used to build
the ships. to clear the land, to transport the timber. They were used in every aspect.
Talk about these shipbuilding yards and where they were. Again, we're talking about 1600s, 1700s.
Yes, well, where they started out were at the ports. And these ports are basically where your large cities were coming up.
Okay,
so these ports were, what turned into your major ports, mm-hmm. was Boston, Rhode Island, New York, and Philadelphia, which became very big ports up in the north, and these were the places where they became the shipbuilding capitals up in the north.
Okay.
Okay? Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, in 1720, Philadelphia, wait a minute, let me make sure, because I want to make sure, yes, in Philadelphia there were at least a dozen shipyards, and that is because there was an abundance of trees in that area, but also because of the waterways Philadelphia in particular, was able to get trees from further away than Boston, mm-hmm. or like in New York. And so what happened is that by 1750, that Philadelphia turned into the capital of making ships.
Okay.
So they became the shipbuilding capital, Philadelphia, by 1750.
All right, and so we actually answered a few questions there. It's like, you know, one of the questions is, so where did they get all of the trees to build all of these ships? And we could say, look at the concrete jungles of the United States. Honestly, you know, a lot of the trees, you know, specifically Philadelphia, you know, prior to colonization, Philadelphia was a straight up forest.
Yes.
You know, we had waterfalls in Philadelphia. We had, you know, Philadelphia was a forest. And then in the middle of this forest, as in most places here, you know, big chiefdoms where you had thousands of peoples cohabitating, you know, mound complexes, and then centered around that, you know, they were living in tune with nature. And so,
and what is interesting though is that many of these ports and these kinds of things were basically set up
next to mound complexes.
Well, how about they took over the mound complexes?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they were utilizing them. Yes, okay. they utilized them because they were already there.
Right.
Why are you going to not use something that is already there?
Okay, you right. Know? And so to get back, so now, okay, the timber being used is coming from the United States.
Yes.
The United States becomes the major capital for shipbuilding for the world for quite a few years, mm-hmm. at least 50 to 100 years. And so let's get into how this happened and why this happened. You know, and specifically, I want to talk about the trees and the timber itself.
Okay, well, one of the things about Philadelphia and why it became the shipbuilding capital is not only because of location, which was, you know, again, being able to bring the things from further away, but by the middle of the 17th century, Boston and New York, they were starting to deplete those trees.
Okay.
And so they needed to start looking for an area now where they can get an abundance of trees. Now, of course, the further west you go where people haven't been living, of course, there's always going to be an abundance of trees here that they could use.
I mean, for United States is so vast.
Yes, yes. But what happened is that what they started looking further south, and then they started realizing that some of the trees that they were finding now in Georgia and South Carolina, that they had particular trees that were called red oak, no, not live. The red oak, the live oak trees, mm-hmm. okay? And live oak was a very dense wood, and they found that this wood was a much better quality oak than just even regular oak.
Okay.
So they started using the this live oak now for the boats, and now you have ships now that will be lasting even longer.
Right.
And not only were they finding this live oak down in the south, but they also found another source for pine trees, mm-hmm. you know, and red cedar then also became popular, especially with that type of boat that was called schooners.
Okay.
The a lot of merchants liked the schooners and the red cedar that was used for the schooners. They were saying because the wood was very dense, it lasted, and but it was also lightweight, so it could make a trip a little bit faster than some of the other ones.
And if I'm not mistaken from the research, that ship's hair being built in the Americas because of the wood. And because of the wood, some of the ships were actually make 2, 3, 4 trips, where the European made ships would only maybe take 1 or 2 at best.
Per year, yes.
Because of all of the upkeep that was necessary.
Right, exactly, yes. Right.
Which leads us to another question. I was wondering if we should include this because it kind of goes off topic. But it doesn't, because, you know, first we're talking about the slave ships and the fact that they existed, the fact that we have so much information about it also verifies all of the information we have to prove the low numbers of Africans being shipped directly into the United States. It's further verification of, you know, the statement that everybody running around with, you know, only 5% of the slave population came directly from Africa. I think I heard that a couple of times.
Okay, yes.
But beyond that, as we contemplate that idea, when we start doing research on the ships and what was happening, and, you know, we started looking, you know, we like to look at the journals, we like to look at the logs, we like to look at the
numbers,
cargo, you know, what was being carried on this trip.
How many were on the ships?
How many people were on the ship? How many were crew members? Versus, you know, how many were passengers.
And you know what
slaves.
Is, you know what is interesting, which we really didn't get to, but the numbers that were on the ships, most of those ships were carrying less than 100 people. The right. ones that I ran into. Mm-hmm. Now, of course, there were that carried more, mm-hmm. but you'll see like the ships that were like schooners and the sloops. They were not very large. Mm-hmm. So they didn't carry a large cargo because they had additional cargo besides slaves
right.
that was being shipped.
It's more money to be made. Just
right,
not.
Right. Yeah, slaves was not the only money source.
Okay. And so as we deal with that reality, you know, we were going through this and we started to see a depletion in the number of slaves being transported into, you know, the colonial United States after this, you know, late 1700s, early 1800s. You know, I wanted to touch on that just a little bit so that, you know, we people can get a, you know, some kind of idea about what was happening with the politics of that time also.
Yes, well, what most people don't realize is that the slave trade itself had been abolished way before 1865.
Mm.
The first Slave Trade Act of the United States was actually in 1794.
Okay.
And let me put my glasses on again. And it was a law that was passed by the United States Congress that limited the United States involvement in the slave trade. It limited involvement, but it didn't stop it. There were several amendments that were added to that, trying to strengthen the act, and they finally came out in 1807. It came out, as a matter of fact, on March 2nd of 1807, and it was a bill that was called, and I have to read it, an act to prohibit the importation of slaves into any part or place within the jurisdiction of the United States from and after the first day of January in the year of our Lord, 1808. So what this means is that what was to begin on January 1st of 1808 is that they were supposed to be outlawing the importation of slaves. Now, what we have to realize is that this was the importation, or bringing them to the shores of the United States. That was outlawed. One thing, though, that it did not outlaw, and that was slavery.
All right, and let's talk about that for a moment, because I think this is why I wanted to bring this up as a part of, you know, slave ships, because it's important. And that's that despite the decrease, and you know, even though it was outlawed, even though, you know, it was outlawed that you could not bring slaves into the United States, that didn't mean that it still wasn't happening. We had pirates and other things. As a matter of fact, the United States was at war at times, and they would actually grab, you know, any ship that they would hold, they would enslave some of those captors. So the United States was actually enslaving and taking over ships during this time, which is another topic.
They could take over a ship, and again, because it was outlawed, then what they could do is they would fine the ship owner.
Okay.
They may find some of the people that were there on the ship, the crew. They may find them. I'm not sure. So they were making money off of that. Mm-hmm. But then they also took the slaves. So they still made money off of the slaves anyway. So
okay, yeah. And so that's crazy. However, beyond that, you see a very large decrease in the number being, you know, directly shipped here.
Yes, though the numbers were small, like we said, anyway, because only about maybe 300,000 during the entire slave trade were brought directly to the shores of the United States. But then we see that after 1800, that there was a very, very small number of slaves that were brought in. But what is interesting is that that is the time that the slave numbers grew substantially.
Right, went boom.
Yes.
You know, which is a whole nother point. And that's why we wanted to include that, you know, it's not referencing the ships, but it is, you know, because, you know, the reality that they're bringing even less in than they have ever, although the number is very small to begin with, 300,000, you know, but now, you know, it's 1800, is outlawed for the most part. So now the numbers is not, instead of bringing in 50,000-60,000, it's not, they're not even bringing that in anymore. But at the same time, the slave population internally just goes boom.
Yes, yes.
You know, further verify that, you know, the slave, quote unquote, slave population in the United States, specifically in the southeastern portions.
Homegrown.
Right, homegrown, ha ha.
Homegrown.
Let's get back to the question, slave ships, you know. Mm-hmm. And so we talked about the reality that, you know, they weren't actually slave ships. They were cargo ships of many varieties, specifically five being
converted
into a ship that was more capable of carrying slaves during the journey. The reality that, well, most of us, and I didn't know this at the time, that the United States was the shipbuilding capital of the world for a couple of years, for quite a while, not mm-hmm. even a few years, mm-hmm. 100 years maybe.
It may still be.
yeah, with respects to timber and wood, right? and these ships that read that so much of our conversation in our community today.
And
so,
just by the way, just to let you know this, that they didn't start using metal on ships until the middle of the 1800s, and so by that time,
shipping, not question anymore.
And shipping slaves on ships that had metal was
right.
And then hardly didn't even happen.
And then we're talking about 1865 now, so now we're talking about a whole different part of, you know, American history. You know, however, we're back to the slave thing, you know, just and these ships thing, you know, they existed, they were these types, they were being converted to ship slaves, you know, we were building ships, Boston, New York, Rhode Island, Philadelphia, you know, and eventually the wood from Georgia and South Carolina turned out to be the best for building the ships, you know, and now we're get to the point where, okay, so now where are they at? You know what I mean? Which is, again, a valuable question. You know, let's figure out, you know, we talked about where the ports were. You know, that was a valuable question. Well, where are the ports where all of these ships was coming in? Well, you know, we talked about that. Y'all can go research, you know, those cities' history, you know, pictures and all kind of stuff. But now, where are the ships?
What happened
to these ships from colonial times and over time? You know, that's a valuable question.
That it is. And let's think about that for a minute. And
right.
If you really think about it, it's like, well, the biggest thing that, I mean, what would you do with something that you cannot use any longer? You want to see if you can use it for something else, mm-hmm. okay? Mm-hmm. And really what happened with ships that were no longer useful to travel with, they would find other uses for them, okay. You know, so... And many of them were used to make other ships. As much as possible was used to even make another ship.
Keep the cost down.
There you go.
Everything about money.
Yes, yes.
Bottom line.
Oh,
right?
yeah, bottom line, yes, yes. Money. Okay. And so now, if you recall the trip with Christopher Columbus, mm-hmm. remember that when he came here, one of his ships got grounded, where it could not make the trip back to Spain. So what they did is that they broke the ship down and they built what they called a settlement, which was called La Navidad,
okay, right.
Which is what they built because he had to leave behind a whole crew mm-hmm. because that whole boat wasn't making it back. So they made this settlement, La Navidad, that they used the wood from the ship, the grounded ship that they could not travel with.
Right.
So I mean, so that's a perfect example right there of one use. All
of
right.
One use.
Yeah, of one use. Yes.
So
one way to reuse the wood from a ship.
But that's just one of the ways that.
That's one way. One way is this: if you have wood that is just totally rotten that you can't use anymore, guess what? There is a use for it. You can burn it to make some heat.
Okay.
Okay.
When we're talking about colonial times now, and so you can, you know, that probably was his own industry. you know, burn wood, you know.
Yes. And also remember, not only for heat though, but they had to use wood to cook with.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now you have this wood that's around, there's no good wood that's just sitting around, you are going to use it, it's going to get used.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, even if you go to the horse stables and stuff today, you see wood. Being burnt in trash cans all over the United States and hoods and underneath highways and stuff like that. You will get burnt. But then that is even more reason. They do use the wood for a whole lot of other things too.
Yes, okay. Well, one thing though is, well, we know that they made them for, they used them for buildings also. So we said that
yeah.
Columbus used it for a settlement, you know. But they also used them here. Even you know, on land here, you know, where you can use it to build a school building, mm-hmm. or you know, you
but,
can
you know,
use it for
special ships. They would use to make furniture.
Oh,
you know, and then they would give their furniture to the kings and queens, and you know, I mean, this is prestigious, this and this from this country or that country, and it was a part of this boat or that boat. You know, I mean, I don't know. Watch some American movies, and you'll see it. You know, I mean, but beyond that. You know what I mean? Beyond that, people are still going to be like, okay, but still, where are the ships?
Ships.
Where are the ships? Where
okay,
the ships?
Well, guess what? There is one amazing fact, and again, after looking this up, I didn't even realize to the extent mm-hmm. that this is.
Okay.
And what this is that there are thousands and thousands of ships that are in what is called ship graveyards.
I'm gonna stop, pause. Thousands?
Thousands.
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 Okay, well, let's see thousands of ships in what they call ship graveyards here in the United States.
Okay, well, there are several ship graveyards, like they're called. Again, they said that one thing, though, that where you will find ship graveyards is outside of every single port that the United States was using in the 18th and 19th century. Okay. You're definitely going to see ship graveyards, okay? Yes. All right, you're going to find them.
Okay.
All right, and there are, like I said, there are several of them. There are several big ones. There is one in particular that they call Mallows Bay. This one is in, this is outside of Virginia.
Okay.
And all of these ship graveyards are going to show ships from the 1700s, 1800s, and the 1900s. Mm. So they're going to show ships from all of them. And what we did is that we found the maps of some of these ship graveyards. Now, one thing about Mallows Bay that they say that you can see them even from Google Earth. What we did, and you will be seeing some of these pictures toward the end, we're going to be showing you some of these pictures, but some of them you can see that some boats are still halfway in the water, halfway out. Mm-hmm. There are some where you can see the image of them right below the water. And of course, a lot of them that, you know, we just can't even see, but they're there.
They're there, right.
They're there. And like we said, some boats were intentionally sunk, and they still do that today to make reefs, mm-hmm, for the environment. Mm-hmm. You know, so some of those were intentionally put there, but a lot of them, they just put there and they left them there.
Okay. All right. Well, you know, that's just, that's just an overview of the question. You know, that's really just an overview of slave ships. You know, what's going on with them? You know, where are they? You know, what exactly are they? You know, I mean, again, they're not slave ships. They're cargo ships of different varieties that were converted to ship slaves. You know, and then beyond that, ports all up and down the East Coast, ship graveyards all up and down the East Coast, specifically Mallows Bay was one of the ones that we mentioned.
Now, then what we're going to do, though, is National Geographic has made several maps which are showing where some of these ships that are off the coast, off the Atlantic coast,
okay,
where they are. Now, and so we're going to be showing, here's like one, for instance, that is showing ships from Massachusetts to Rhode Island, mm-hmm, okay?
Right.
And then there's another one that is showing from Cape Henry, Virginia, down to Cape Fear, North Carolina. Mm-hmm. There's a bunch of ships there.
Well, you know what? As they look at those pictures, you know, let's wrap it up for them. And, you know, let me just say to you, we really do appreciate you checking us out. Thank you very much for giving us the time to share this information with you. We are doing a whole lot of things, and so we definitely would like for you to be involved, so please subscribe to us on our YouTube page. If you haven't liked us on Facebook, please like our page, Indigenous Education. And we always put in some new, we will consistently be putting some information out there. We have some educational lessons that we're offering online. And so if you're interested, definitely check our Facebook page out. We hit the flyer out on there. We'd like to thank Red Silver Fox. Thank you very much. This is really good information. And again, as we go over what they call what Del Mar Valve, which is what we're going to be showing y'all now, which is a list of, would you say, how many different ships?
Well, there are over 2,400 ships.
Just in this
area, which is the, and again, let me make sure. It is showing from the waters off the Delaware coast to the waters of the Chesapeake Bay.
Okay.
Over 2,400 wrecks there under the water.
So thousands of slave ships, yes, where are they? Check the Dharma Law, as they said, right? But anyway, thank you very much. Please stay tuned. We have a lot more information. Please like us on Indigenous Education Facebook page. Subscribe us on YouTube. And thank you very much.
Peace.
Peace.
Different than you, shit. More money, more problems. I solemnly swear to tell you the truth. Allow me to reintroduce myself.
Welcome
to the cruel world that we all living in. Still chasing them dividends, whether it's thousands or millions. It's still a hustle, ain't it? The grind is universal.
Peace and welcome to part three of Where Are the Slave Ships? I'm Red Tail Hawk, also known as Tavis Sanders. I'd like to welcome my mother, Red Silver Fox, also known as Renee Sanders.
Greetings.
So in this episode, we are going to discuss some of the, I guess, final points with respect to the slave ships. You know, why so little evidence of slave ships, some of the locations, maybe talk about some specific ships that we know of, and, you know, also go over, you know, how they can tell what the differences are between different types of ship as they are going over the slave wrecks. I'm sorry, the shipwrecks themselves. Mm-hmm. And I guess, speaking of shipwrecks, again, this is part three of Where Are the Slave Ships? And if you're interested in taking a look at part one and part two, we discuss not only the shipwrecks themselves and where some of them can be found, you know, why, what happened to these ships, you know, once they were done being used, you know, recycling and other things like that. We talked about where the ships were being built, some of the ports, why specific wood was being used. And it also being an economic boost to the United States economy for 100 years, seeing as though they were all being built here.
Well, many of them were being built here.
Right, right. And so with that, let's wrap it up here and let's finish it off with the wrecks themselves. And let's get into some specifics, wrecks that we know are slave wrecks. But, you know, and talk about, I guess, why so many first.
Well, why it is not so many.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And the thing is that very few slave ship wrecks have been found.
Mm-hmm.
And it's for, there's a few reasons for it, but basically the biggest reason is that when people are looking for ships, they're looking for treasures.
Mm-hmm.
And they know that they're not going to find any treasures on a slave ship.
All right. Money.
Yes, the slave ships were holding cargo and slaves, and that was it. So there wasn't anything valuable, really, nope. Yeah. That were on slave ships. So they're not going to dive or go looking for slave ships.
Okay.
And one of the most obvious reasons is that they deteriorate.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so especially if they get into the water, water deteriorates very quickly.
Okay.
You know, so... And then there are things.
What are deteriorous things quickly?
Oh, yes, very, very quickly.
Especially wood.
Know, especially wood, you know, mm-hmm. And even iron deteriorates after a while, mm-hmm. You know. Mm-hmm. And so, so really to have these things preserved, we know that it's going to take a lot of money to do that.
Okay, you mean after they actually find a ship, it's the cost of preserving this location so that they can do the research on what it is, where it came from, what else is on the ship, because, you know, they're going to have to dig through sand, they got to do a whole lot of things, but I guess we can get into that now.
Yes, well, yes, because we know that when these ships go down, that, again, that they're exposed to water.
Mm-hmm.
The ones that sit in water are going to deteriorate. So the only parts that are not going to deteriorate or deteriorate as quickly are the ones or the pieces and parts that get buried in the sand and the sediment underground.
Okay.
You know, so if they get into that, then the sand can preserve the things, but it's still going to deteriorate.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So again, the thing is that once, if they were to bring that out into the open air, then the open air is going to deteriorate the things. You know, so so those things have, those factors have to be taken into consideration even when they find any of these things.
And again, so we're talking about a lot of logistics and a lot of the process of preserving things before you can even get it on shore so that it can go through the testing and the verification on that level of things.
Yes.
And so again, yes, a lot of money has to be spent in order to do this.
Yes, and over centuries, mm-hmm, that some of these ships have been buried under the sand, sand then accumulates. Right. And so some of these things are buried under 6 and 8 feet of sand, mm-hmm, you know, over the centuries that they have, right, been underground.
200, 300, 400, 500 years sometimes.
Yes, mm-hmm, yes. Mm-hmm. You know, so again, you have to know where they went down, and then you have to know that, then you have to have the equipment that is going to find these things buried that far underneath of the sand. Uh-huh. And so it's expensive.
Right.
It is expensive.
However, just like you said, the ones that they do find buried under the sand, they can find a lot more of the ship itself, and a lot of the things that was on the ship can be preserved.
They can be preserved, and we are going to discuss some of those things, you know, as we go through some when we go through some of the sites, we're going to say how they, what process was done.
Okay.
With especially one in particular, there was a process, because some of the artifacts that they found are now in a museum.
Okay, well, let's talk about that. I think it's called the Slave Wrecks Project.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so yeah, let's give them some information regarding this ongoing process of organization out there trying to find slave wrecks so that they can document and preserve that part of our history.
Yes, yeah, so there it is called, again, the Slave Wrecks Project, and it was founded in 2008. And it was founded by researchers from George Washington University, from the Iziko Museums of South Africa, the South African Heritage Resource Agency, the United States Park Service, Diving with a Purpose, and the African Center for Heritage Activities. And even with all of those organizations that started this in 2008, the African American History Museum of the United States, that's in DC, joined this also a couple of years later.
Okay, and so if you don't mind me jumping in real fast, you just named a whole lot of organizations that have been actively for what, almost 10 years? Matter of fact, it's 2018 now.
Yes.
For 10 years, actively participating in the research and analysis to actually, and fundraising in order to go out there and document this.
Why you think? Slave ships in particular.
Yeah. Okay, we back. Had a little bit of technical difficulties with our logo, but we gonna keep it moving. We hate to ruin the day, so we're just gonna keep that going, right?
Okay, let's go.
Okay, so centered around the slave project,
mm-hmm,
and all of these various organizations that have been putting this work in for over 10 years, providing fact-based research and analysis, and also doing a lot of fundraising in order to provide the general public with this type of information.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yet the question floated around in our community for quite a while, you know. However, let's take a look at what these organizations have found, and other organizations, as far as actual slave wrecks.
Okay, all right.
Okay.
I have to put my glasses on.
All right.
Okay, but one site was discovered in 1991.
Okay.
Off of Martinique, and this is in the Gulf.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, in the islands. And there is a small island where a slave ship went off. Okay, what they found an elephant tusk that was found in the coral, and they're saying that probably marked the site of the slave trade.
Okay.
I'll explain that in a second.
Okay.
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 It says that all that remained of the ship itself were an anchor and a short length of chain, together with a hinge from the rudder. All right. Around the ivory tusk, there were a few hundred bricks, but that's all that they found of the ship, and it says that the ship had completely broken up.
Okay, wow.
Okay.
So, you know, there's a lot of interesting things there that we can touch on as we move further along in the discussion,
mm-hmm,
but one of the things that point out, now that jumped right out at me, is bricks. why, you know, they shipping bricks. You can make bricks anywhere, right? Why ship bricks? But we'll get back. I guess we're getting into that a little bit later. But, you know, we don't want to just dwell, and there's a lot to go over. So let's talk about another site.
Okay. Close to 100 elephant tusks, okay, were found in 1987 at another site. And this one is off of France. This is off of Brittany, France, okay? Again, they didn't find any trace of the ship itself, but it said that what remained were some cargo, some beads that they used for trade,
okay?
A copper bracelet, and Manila, which was a form of trade, a form of money, okay, that was used off of the African coast, that they used as a form of currency off the African coast.
Right. Now, which is also something interesting that we can get into a little bit later on as far as the beads were concerned. But this one is specific.
And also the elephant tusks.
Okay, yeah. Right, well, so again, a lot, you know, a lot to talk about. But let's go on. Let's talk about another. Let's just name a few more sites for them before
okay.
we go.
Okay, all right. There was another ship that was found. This ship, as a matter of fact, went down in 1841.
Okay.
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 And this was found. It was found off of the coast of Australia. Yes, it was found off the coast of Australia.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
But what happened?
Do you want to talk about? Well, go ahead.
Well, let me finish talking about that ship,
okay,
so that I can explain what happened, okay?
Okay.
It was seized in 1837, all right? The United States Royal Army found the ship when it was engaged in the unlawful trade of slave trade.
Mm-hmm.
So in 1837, it was unlawful for them to have the slave trade. So the army seized the ship. And then they just refitted the ship to be just a regular cargo ship.
Mm-hmm.
And then it went back out and as being a cargo ship. But then they later found it off of the coast of Australia.
Okay.
So that's how they know it was a slave ship,
mm-hmm,
because it had been seized and they changed it over.
And so they had documents.
Yes.
So they,
yes.
they and they knew exactly where their ship was.
Yes.
And just to, you know, just to clarify a point, it was the importation of slaves into the United States was illegal.
Yes.
Not slavery itself.
Yes.
You know, however,
yeah, we explained that in part two.
In part two. So
yes.
If you want to learn more about that, definitely check out part two of Where Are the Slave Ships. And so I know, so let's talk about another site. We got another site to talk about.
Okay,
Where are the slave ships? What do you mean, where are the slave ships? They everywhere.
Now, this particular slave ship was found off of the coast of Cape Town, Africa. Mm-hmm. And it was some of these artifacts that are on display in the African American Museum in Washington, D.C.
What? Okay. Nah.
What is interesting? Yes. What is interesting about this ship is that it was leaving Africa on its way to the Americas.
Okay.
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 And while it was leaving, it went underwater.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so they knew exactly where this slave ship was all the time.
So they could actually, you know, and if you're not familiar with this, what was the name of this ship again?
Okay, wait a minute, let me see what the name of it. The Sao Jose.
The Sao Jose, okay.
Okay.
You know, that way y'all can check that out. But if you're not aware of that, they actually saved a lot of the slaves that were on that ship at that time.
They saved half of the slaves that were on that.
Mm-hmm.
They saved all of the crew.
Of course.
Of course, right.
Hold on, wait a second. The captain didn't go down?
Of course not.
Okay.
Yeah, and they did save half of the slaves.
Okay, you know,
of course that was at least part of the cargo that
right. And you know, we're not making light of it, but you know, sometimes you gotta laugh at this stuff because it's crazy, you know. Now, so nonetheless, they actually knew exactly where this ship was, and so for how many years no one even bothered to do any, because it wasn't important and it wasn't worth any money.
And not only that though, because of its location. Mm-hmm. The ocean is very violent, you know, very close to the shore. You know, you have your tides that come in and out all of the time.
Okay.
So even when they went down to this ship and they, you know, they started diving for artifacts and things, a lot of the things were buried under 6 to 8 feet of sand. Mm. And they, when they would retrieve some of the items, they couldn't bring everything at one time, you know.
Okay.
And so some things they would leave. Mm-hmm. And the thing is that when they went maybe a few days later, it was covered back up with 3 to 4 feet of sand. Because, again, of the ocean. So,
well,
and that is something that you have to take into consideration. Again, this one was very close to shore. It's mm-hmm. very easy to get to. But because of the ocean and what happens, mm-hmm. it's just difficult. And again, time-consuming. And a very high monetary cost.
Right. Well, let's talk about some of the things that they found on this particular ship, because it gives, you know, credence to what we expect to find on other shipwrecks.
Yes.
Slave wrecks.
Yes. Okay. And we can also discuss what we were talking about, the elephant tusks.
Okay.
Also.
Right. And okay. the beads.
Yes. Mm-hmm. But what they found on this ship is an iron ballast.
Okay.
And iron ballasts were used, it says, to offset the relatively light weight of the ship's human cargo.
Mm, that's really interesting, which draws us back to the bricks. Right. You know, that, you know, why are you shipping bricks to offset the cargo? Because human weight is different. First of all, you know, dead weight is different from live weight. And so dead slaves would carry weight differently on the ship than live slaves, just to start,
or even if you say maybe a 50-pound sack of potatoes, you know, mm-hmm. you're packing a whole bunch of those. That weight is going to be less
centralized. First of all, it's not moving around,
right? Mm-hmm. You know, and yes, and again, yeah, and they needed it to balance the ships.
Okay, right. And so one of the things that we're going to be looking for are weights that they would put on these slave ships to balance the mm-hmm. cargo to make sure it doesn't sink.
Yes, yes.
And, you right. know, I guess a ballast in some places, bricks in other places. Huh?
Right, if you don't have the ballast.
Cheaper, right?
Go yes, ahead. Yes. Okay, but they also found, they found a wooden pulley block, mm-hmm. okay? They found remnants of shackles, and these were covered, they said, in organic and inorganic material that had built up around them over centuries being in the sea.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
And really, it took them for them to find out that they were even shackles, because they were even deteriorating. Okay. Mm-hmm. But what they did is that it says that the remains of these fragile shackles could only be identified using either CT scans or X-rays. And when they did the scans, they said that they were able to find the ghost of a shackle that remained in the remnants
right.
that they found.
Okay.
Okay. It says the iron is barely there, but what you can see is a clear outline of what once existed as a shackle.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, and I see here we also have a quote from one of the divers that's talk about the tides being like a giant washing machine,
mm-hmm.
you know, so you can imagine all of the sand and, you know, everything just being moved around consistently over there. And it's just going to wear everything down. Nothing is going to stay underneath there permanently.
Yes. And they said that even after things have been carefully vacuumed off, within a few hours, the sand had recovered the site. And within a day or so, it says 2 to 3 feet of sand back over the site.
Okay. Wow.
So, and again, it was from this ship where some of these artifacts are being displayed in the African American Museum in Washington, D.C.
Okay. So you can look at those and, you know, I guess to get some historical context, you know, as a part of that tour. All right, so we discussed some of those sites, and let's get into some of the sites that might be a little bit closer for people to get to here in the States. We got a few, well, one in particular here, a site here in the States that we can give a lot of information about. I ain't no different than you, shit. More money, more problems. I solemnly swear to tell you the truth. Allow me to reintroduce myself. Welcome to the cruel world that we all living in. Still chasing them dividends. Whether it's thousands or millions, it's still a hustle, ain't it? The grind is universal. Might take muscle to gain the upper hand. Some understand there ain't no perfect picture painted. I do what I gotta do. I ain't no different than you. Shit. I ain't no different than you. Shit. More money, more problems. I solemnly swear to tell you the truth. Allow me to reintroduce myself. Welcome to the cruel world that we all living in. Still chasing them dividends. Whether it's thousands or millions, it's still a hustle, ain't it? The grind is universal. Might take muscle to gain the upper hand. Some understand there ain't no perfect picture painted. I do what I gotta do. I ain't no different than you. All right, so we discussed some of those sites, and let's get into some of the sites that might be a little bit closer for people to get to here in the States. We got a few, well, one in particular here, a site here in the States that we can give a lot of information about.
Yes, and now again, there are a few other sites. They're not really around the United States that have been found.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
But this one has been found off of the keys of Florida.
Okay.
And it's called the Henrietta Marie. And the Henrietta Marie was discovered in 1972 by treasure hunters. Again, people that are diving for treasures, okay? It sank off of Key West, Florida in 1700. And it was on its way back to England after it had dropped off a shipment of slaves in Jamaica.
Okay.
Okay, so they do know that.
Okay.
And it says that very little of the ship was found, but it, you know, they do know that it was a cargo ship, and that it was a cargo ship that was shipping slaves.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So give us some more information about the history of the Henrietta Marie.
Okay. Well,
since we know what it is, you know, since we have a name, let's talk about it.
All right. Well, at first it belonged to the French.
Okay.
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 And the French were using it in the Anglo-French War, and that war ended in 1697.
Okay.
All right. After that war, the English Navy mm-hmm. captured the ship, and they brought it back to England. And when they did that, they refitted the ship.
Okay. Okay. So another one of those ships converted to ship slaves.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So it said that they refitted the ship, and the new owners renamed the ship the Henrietta Marie.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that it had two voyages. So it only had two voyages as a slave ship.
Mm.
All right.
Mm.
The first one was in November of 97. And it says that it was able to carry many different kinds of freight, because it had many different cargo decks.
Okay.
So it didn't just have one or two cargo decks. It had many cargo decks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And it says that they had things for trade, including iron, beads, pewter, weapons, and slaves. And it says that the Henrietta Marie could carry about 200 people in their cargo area.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
So that was the first trip. It was in late of in 1698 it began its first ship, and then it came back.
Okay.
So it went, came back and then it came back to England.
Okay It went to Africa, to America, back to England.
Okay When it got back to England, it got back in late 1698. All right So when it came back, they began fixing it again so that it could go back out again.
Mm-hmm.
So the ship had to be refitted.
Mm-hmm.
It had to, you know, things had to get repaired. They had to get a new crew because, you know, again, that was, you know, almost 2 years had passed. So they had to get a new crew, and they had to get new investors also, because, you know, every time the ship sails out, you have different investors. You know, you just don't have the same investors that invest all the time, you know.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So you had to get all of these things together before a ship would even sail.
Okay.
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 So it wasn't until late of 1699, so it took over a year, before the ship was able to sail again.
Okay.
Okay?
Okay.
And so...
Well, before you go on, for those that are interested in doing the research on this particular ship, one of the things that we wanted to point out was that if you are going to slavevoyages.org and you're looking for the ship, they actually have it leaving port in 1700, not 1699. So that's a little bit, you know, a difference between the database and history. You know, just
yes,
little
and
small
it thing. took us a minute for us to find it, you know, because when we went there, we started searching in 1698, 1697, because it did have a voyage.
Right, right.
But we were able to find it in 1700.
Yeah, okay. So let's talk about some of the things that was found on the Henrietta Marie.
Okay. Now, what they found is, it says that they found 80 sets of shackles.
80. Okay.
Two cast iron cannons, mm-hmm. which many of those ships, they travel with cannons.
Well, it used to be a warship, right? It was a ship used on war, so cannons.
And really, all ships travel with cannons. I mean, mm-hmm. they're going, can you say Pirates of the Caribbean? You know, so, so they all had cannons on them, okay?
Okay.
Glass tray beads. So here we go with the beads. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Which the Negroes would like to use for trade,
that's
right?
Negroes.
Negroes, right.
Just like to use the beads as for trade, yes. Stock iron tray bars. Okay. Uh-huh. So they had that. Ivory elephant's teeth. So again, here we go with the elephant's teeth. And remember we said before that elephant tusks were found.
Right.
And the reason why they, and that's how they could identify that some of these ships were slave ships, mm-hmm. because if the ship did not stop in Africa, then it would not have it would not have tusks, it would not have teeth, it would not have the manila, the trade good, you know. And so
it wouldn't have a lot of the things, specifically ivory.
Right. Yeah, mm-hmm. and yes, things that are known to come from the African
right,
coast.
Indigenous to Africa
yes.
itself, right.
Okay.
Especially
and
going that route.
All right, and they also found a large collection of pewter, English-made pewter tankards. They found basins, spoons, bottles, and they also found the ship's bell.
Okay, and the ship's bell. Let's talk about that for a mm-hmm. second. Tell us what a ship bell is, number, you know.
Okay, well, really, yeah, the bells were made to identify the ships, that they often had the name and the date stamped on the bell that would identify,
yeah,
you know,
like
would
the
identify.
Boat marked,
yes,
right. They do
yes.
that now. They, you know, every boat has a name.
Yes. Okay. Now, when they found the bell had been underwater for 300 years.
Mm.
Okay.
Wow.
So it was totally covered, as it with marine growth. Okay. Mm-hmm. There was stuff mm-hmm. all over. We're going to show an
natural
image,
coral.
A partial image of what some of it, you know,
okay.
What it looked like. Yes. And it says that after removing some of the growth, that they found the name Henrietta Marie, and they found the date 1699 inscribed on that bell.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now that they found the bell, because now really what happened is that they found the ship in 72, but it wasn't, it was like almost 10 years later when they went back down mm-hmm. for the dive.
Okay.
And when they went back down for the dive, that's when they found the bell. Okay. And now that they found the bell, they can now go back into records. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like we did when we went to slave voyages, we could go now, and even in slavevoyages.org, we could find out who the captain of the ship was. We could find mm-hmm. out how many people were there. Mm-hmm. You know, there's several items that we could even find just on slavevoyages.org. But if you go back to England, you'll find a lot more. You'll find the captain's logs and right. all the information that, you know, so all of these things are preserved. You know, so there are things that you can find out that in history, you know, that if we didn't have those captain's logs and if we didn't have those things, you know, how do you preserve history?
Right.
You know, and
right.
so we must go back to these things
mm-hmm.
so that we can preserve the accurate history.
Yeah.
We have to go to those records because those are the only records that we have that document these things.
Yep, and then we got to make sure that we have the correct perspective from an indigenous, as far as indigenousness is concerned, as we factually provide this to the public.
Yes.
You know, it's really important.
Yes, it is. Because again, if these divers had not found that bell, to identify that ship, that just would have been another ship.
We're not sure what kind of ship.
Exactly.
However, we do know one thing, no treasure, let's move on.
Yes, not exactly.
Right? We're actually, yes. You know, and I guess now, and again, as you said before, as we begin to wrap the situation up, we might have a little bit more, but the organizations, you know, over the last 10 years have been, you know, looking for funding and getting started. And, you know, when people ask questions, you know, it's not just, it's a responsibility for individuals to get, you know, to answer the question. We can't just allow questions to float around without being answered.
And you have to do your due diligence to find the information also. It's not something that you could just go and Google and you will get an answer the first time that you Google it.
Mm-hmm,
you know, it is extensive research. We did this over several weeks, mm-hmm. just this one topic. And really, that was on top of research that we had already done.
Right.
You know, so this is, you know, it's not something that you could just go in 2 minutes and find the answers.
Well, you know, and as far as other individuals that's out here that are, you know, being heard and seen, is really, you know, we have a responsibility as indigenous peoples to be responsible for ourselves, our actions, our words, and the impact that it has on our community.
Yes, and to be accurate with the information that we are passing out to people.
Right, we don't want
to. As just, accurate as possible.
And there's always room for development, there's always room for growth.
Oh, yes. Because history is not static.
Right. And with that, you know, which is where I really wanted to take this at, and as far as we're closing out, is that, and you know, if we have questions that we would like to be answered, and we want them to be answered by from our perspective, then we have to be willing to put the work in to actually get that done. And so, you know, instead of having a question like, where are the slave ships, to run around for a year, have all these people screaming this, you know, somebody should have actually went on ahead and said,
let's find out.
You know, it's not any one individual's responsibility. It's our responsibility as an indigenous people. Especially now, it's very important as we are in the very infancy stages of our re-education and reintroduction to our media history. It's mm-hmm. really important.
Yes, it is. You know, yes, it is.
You know, responsibility is important.
Okay, well, before we wrap it up, I would like to just mention two places that are here in the United States that have devoted their time to this Henrietta Marie, to the slave ship itself.
One of them by us, right?
Well, one is in West Virginia.
Okay.
And is from the West Virginia Division of Culture and History. Mm-hmm. And you can go look that up. And as a matter of fact, we will have, we're going to have our bibliography at the end of this. And these places that I'm mentioning, we'll also have them there so that you can go look for the information yourself if you would like to.
Okay.
And the other place is called the Mel Fisher Maritime Heritage Society and Historical Museum. And that one is in Key West, Florida.
Mm-hmm.
So these two places, and as a matter of fact, the West Virginia Division of Culture and History, they even made a replica of the ship. It's a smaller model, but they did make a replica of it.
We're talking about the Henrietta Marie.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
And as we discuss the Henry, just, you know, let's not leave out the, what's this called here? It's called the National Association of Black Scuba Divers. You know, and you know, let's just discuss what they did with respect to this Henrietta Marie, and about, you know, our active participation as us as a people, and how we really need to jump into this. Let's talk about what they did.
Yes, well, they are part of one of those groups that is called Diving with a Purpose.
Okay.
And these black divers, and what they did is they decided to make a plaque that is a memorial. Mm-hmm. And it is a bronze marker, which is facing the African shore, and it is a marker that they placed there in 1993, and they placed it at the site of where they found the Henrietta Marie.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and again, we will show an example
of
that.
Yeah, we can have that show right now
yes.
as we wrap it up, and you know, and again, you know, it's a lot of other things. There's a lot of other directions that you can take these questions. And, you know, we would like to ask people, too, because, you know, we all should be supporting each other and developing this information from a historically, from an indigenous historic perspective. However, We have to make sure it's fact-based as
yes,
well.
Yes, yes.
You know, and again, I guess that would go for everything, you know, as we develop this and we step into this new age of things, right?
Yes.
Okay, so with that, you know, I guess, you know, we could show some of the bibliographies before we show the credits right now. And we'd like to say thank you very much. Please look us up on Facebook at Indigenous Education. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel if you have not subscribed yet. We're going to be coming out with a lot of new information. If you are interested through Indigenous Education, we are hosting bi-weekly educational lessons on the history and the development of Indigenous peoples right now. And so,
fact-based,
yeah. And so if you're interested, please email us. And you can, we can give you the registration process. And again, they're $10 donations if you're interested in that. And be on the lookout. We have a couple other shows coming up. We're going to be answering some comments and some questions. So that always, they always like that one right there. Okay. We kind of like that one too.
Yes.
And we're going to be doing a few other things. So please stay tuned. Be on the lookout for us the rest of this year. It's going to be a great year. So with that being said, peace.
Peace.
Different than you, shit. More money, more problems. I solemnly swear to tell you the truth. Allow me to reintroduce myself.
Welcome
to the cruel world that we all living in. Still chasing them dividends, whether it's thousands or millions. It's still a hustle, ain't it? The grind is universal. Might take muscle to gain the upper hand. Some understand there ain't no perfect picture painted. I do what I gotta do. I ain't no different than you, shit. From the corner to the corporate offices,
people around here
ain't playing about their money, sonny. Hungry wolves on the prowl. But I'm a veteran, most decorated 4-star general, Colin Powell. And it don't take a rocket scientist to know that I'll
never
surrender my flag. Never pretend Yamasee ain't shining. I'm the golden child.
I think to myself, if I were up here in front of you right now, and this is going to become very important as you move, I move into the other slides. If I stomped a puppy to death out here, up here, just a little puppy, and stomped it right here to death in front of you, most of you would need therapy. And I would be arrested probably faster than killing a black man for killing a puppy. Now, I want you to look at this photo very closely, and I want you to see who's in it. More important than the man hanging, because you got to understand the lynchings that occurred in America happened after slavery, not during. Thousands of lynchings happened after slavery, because this is a reaction to white fear of what we would do once freed. But we didn't create a vigilante group to take out white people, but they did create a vigilante group to take us out now that we're free. See, that happened after slavery. They were called the what? The Ku Klux Klan. They don't wear hoods anymore. They wear suits. But they're alive and well all over the world, even here. So, look at who's in the picture. I want you to look at this little girl in particular. You can't see her closely, but she's actually grimacing, like smirking. Now, remember, let's go back to the puppy concept here. She would be loathed and torn up probably if this was a puppy, which means he's less than that, because she's not disturbed. This little girl is not disturbed by this, but she should be, shouldn't she? People always ask me, they go, Joy, what was the impact on white people? There it is. Right there. Can't feel any empathy for him. None, zero, zip. There's a little one back here, even smaller. Because whatever she's been taught or told, socialized to believe, makes him no longer human. That's the greatest danger to white people, is that they can't feel it. And there's a reason why white people can't feel what we're talking about. My God, what would you then feel? It's tough. So I've got to believe, oh, it's all over now. It's not my fault. I don't benefit. It's not a big deal. Let's move on. It's not all of those things. But we don't say that to Jewish people. I dare you. But you have to understand, when you unearth this one, that's what we did to our children. Let's move forward. This is a similar photo to the one that is used in Denzel's movie. Now, and again, most important, this is a man that's being burned. Also, I won't read the depiction, but there are newspaper accounts of this. It's written in a book called 100 Years of Lynching by Ginsberg. No pictures, just newspapers that say not only did they burn him, they decapitated him, cut him into pieces, and used parts of his body as things to put on mantles. So people would say, get me a tongue, would you, or a liver, a little crisp, so I could put it on the mantle. Now, again, I want you to look at the folks. I want you to look at who's here. We're not talking about the toothless, big gut, hooded wonder, are we? We're looking at plain old, common, dressed up folks. They're squeezing, please, I want my picture taken. Are you following me? This is somebody's cousin, uncle, somebody. And the ability to do that, dehumanize this man and rob them of their humanity all at the same time. All at the same time. That is the most dangerous, treacherous thing that could happen. What did Hitler do? He dehumanized human beings, put babies in ovens. Anything that robs us of our humanity is a danger to everyone. And that is what's going on with people of African descent all over the world, because not only did it get done here, but who did we tell the entire world we told these people don't deserve any value? Everyone wants to be American, not y'all. But when we go, I mean, I literally go to countries all over the world. America sets the standard, and thank God for what happened later. Let's move forward. So a lot of people start saying, well, y'all got free, right? Y'all are free. Everything's fine. Because see, whenever you talk about post-traumatic slave syndrome, people get locked there. So there's a myth that after slavery ended, the playing field was leveled. Was it? Remember, all the lynchings occurred after slavery. That wasn't during, after slavery. So you had black sharecropping. Now, we didn't get a lot of black history in our schooling. I have 4 degrees and 3 of them advanced degrees. Never did I get black history. I got about 2 pages of black history, and one page was a picture. And it was a picture of the little folks with the cabin. You probably saw the same picture. It's a little cabin. The little guy on the porch with the banjo. Little children running, frolicking about, eating watermelon. Right? Everybody happy? And we certainly need little Mary and little Johnny to believe that they were happy. The slaves were happy people. And they had a nice place to live. Because we couldn't have them feeling cognitive what? Not little Mary. She can't start questioning what Grandpa did. So I want you to see this, because those are leftover slave quarters. He's a sharecropper. So now let's go back and take a look at sharecropping. Now, these are folks that were slaves, no longer slaves, decided I'm going back to be a sharecropper on the same plantation that I was enslaved. Why would you do that? You all heard about Katrina, yes? Yeah. See, I was there. My family's from Louisiana. I went to the 9th Ward. Sometimes you can't pay attention to what the news says. It's important to actually go eyeball what's going on, which was very interesting, because it was one of the most horrific events I'd ever seen and probably will ever see in my life. Well, black folks were just simply treated differently. Did you notice that? Here's the good news about Katrina. Everybody noticed it. So all the rest of the world, where we learn, send us your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, your democracy, your equality. They said, what happened with that Katrina thing? All that stuff y'all talked about. Well, let me read this. This is from Associated Press, taken straight from the newspaper. In the front, actually, the top part here is actually a woman, but they think it's a man. Anyway, it says, a young man walks through chest-deep floodwater after looting a grocery store in New Orleans on Tuesday, August 30th, 2005. Same body of water down here, excuse me. 2 residents wade through chest-deep water after finding bread and soda from a local grocery store. Now, same event, same water. White people, black people. We've told you what you see now. That removes your what? Dissonance, because these people can't be perceived as looting. They're white people. White people don't loot. Now, the truth of the matter is, I don't care what any of them are doing. It doesn't matter, but I'm going to still the social conscience by letting you know, don't forget, this is a looter. Matter of fact, what you last heard was that they were looters and rapists. Did you not? So don't they deserve it? That wasn't back in, slavery though, was it? Now we're going to kind of move into operationalizing that to look at what is it, how do we begin to connect that behavior, that history to what we're dealing with and what you're dealing with right now and what we're seeing. And very often people say, well, is everything post-traumatic slave syndrome? Obviously that would, trivialize all the work. You know, we cannot lay squarely on the shoulders of post-traumatic all the problems that we see, nor can we place all the problems squarely on the shoulders of white people or any of the above. So hopefully we won't digress into anything that is that foolish in terms of a discussion. Because, that's another thing that happens in terms of trying to deal with the pushback around this. Then we move into extremes, and it tends to dilute the realities that are going on. So hopefully we're way beyond all that. Well, now she's saying everything is post-traumatic. No, I'm not. And most of my work, my background is really in the field, doing work in the community and grassroots. That's where my training was in terms of my clinical work. And just, the fact that I've always been, this work started on the ground. It didn't start here. Matter of fact, I got the attention of places like Oxford and Harvard and, the Ivy League and major institutions, even the FBI, but those were things that happened after started doing the work on the grassroots level. And so it's, for me, my commitment is to healing. So this is not an exercise in some kind of broad intellectual esoteric. It's really about how do we then take this information and help a person extricate themselves from behavior that they've learned and or been socialized to believe, black and white and everyone in the middle that's been affected by this. What do we do? So this is kind of looking at the contemporary kind of reflection of the trauma. Which is white supremacy and terrorism. That continues. We see that on a daily basis in the United States as well as here. This book is called Breaking Rank by Norm Stamper. Norm Stamper is a 34-year police veteran. He was a chief of police for the cities of San Diego and Seattle. This is a white man wrote this book called Breaking Rank, and he really did. So all I can tell you is he broke rank. I've been trying to meet Norm. Norm travels quite a bit, and he gets a considerable amount of death threats because of what he's done. But he talked about, and this is contemporary. And remember, that's what we're looking at. How does it reflect itself today? I've heard some police officers refer to prostitute slayings or to the slayings of blacks as misdemeanor murders, employing an unofficial code for them, NHI, which means no human involved. Now, these are on telephone calls. These are on calls that you hear on police officers speaking. Hey, what do you have? Well, we have an NHI. We have no human involved. It's a black person killed. Do you see what I'm saying? Again, the dehumanization reflecting itself in just their casual involvement with one another. San Diego cops confess to a myriad other acts of discrimination, including additionally dehumanizing the references to blacks on a radio call, just an 1113 nigger. 1113 is a code for an injured animal.
What people do is they talk to the wrong people, and they talk to a lot of these weak behind Moors in these Moor science temples. Let me explain. I don't take sides, and I'm going to say this again. The weak behind Moor science temple Moors. If you are Moor that's in the temple, you got an issue that is not severe based problem. I am not a Moor science temple Moor. But don't go to the Moor science temple thinking that they are the answers to everything that's going on. Period. Don't go to them. They don't even have no credibility. None. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco. I talked to a brother last night about this. Listen to me. Listen, I want y'all to get what I'm saying to y'all. All of these boys doing these videos on YouTube and Facebook talking crazy. I will call your bluff. I will call your bluff. They don't call themselves Moors, people in Morocco.